Okay, here we are in part two of Rose for Emily. Emily had vanquished them, just as she had vanquished their fathers 30 years before about the smell. So now we're taking a big step back chronologically. Notice we're jumping in time. This is a non-linear pattern of storytelling. We started with death, then we moved back a certain period of time to this conflict over the taxes. And now we're moving back further to 30 years before her death about the smell, okay? And this was after her father's death and a short time after her sweetheart had deserted her, okay? So we learn already that after her father's death, she became kind of a shut-in. She went out very little, and then when her sweetheart went away, we hardly saw her at all. And no one would be received in her house, and the only sign of life about the place was the manservant, okay? And he was the only one who would go in and out with a kitchen basket, okay? Now, a smell developed, and the world outside, this is, you know, this gross smell is now the connection between the modern world and Emily's old world, okay? So, this town tries to figure out, what do we do with this old lady shut in and the fact that her house reeks? The judge tries to deal with it, but they get more complaints. They keep telling the judge, we got to send word to her. We got to tell her to clean this place up. And notice what the judge says here. This is something that really reeks of, really reeks of the traditional hierarchy and aristocracy here and manners. Like, would you accuse a lady to her face of smelling bad? Like, there's something indecent about that accusation, and so we shouldn't do it, okay? So rather than confront her in person, what happens is four men cross into her lawn and slink around like burglars. They creep across the lawn and sprinkled lime down in the cellar. After breaking into the cellar door, and they sprinkle lime in there to kind of absorb the odor. And people began to really feel sorry for her. People in our town began to remember how one of her aunts had gone a little crazy. And then notice this point, that the Griersons themselves held themselves a little too high for what they really were. So there's this contrast between how the Griersons thought of themselves and what the reality was, okay? Notice too that we get a we. That's one of the first we's we've seen. It might be the first. And this is one reason why the story seems like it's narrated in the first person plural. But notice, we thought of them as a tableau, as a kind of painting or scene, with Miss Emily as a slender figure in white, her father a silhouette in the foreground, and the two of them framed by the back-flung front door. So they more see them, the town more sees these two as like a picture rather than as real entities, as real people. And they felt a little bit vindicated when she was still unmarried at 30, becoming now a spinster. And they figure she never really had any chances to get married, okay? When her father dies, she has left the house and nothing else. And now the people pity Miss Emily. She was alone and a pauper, and this humanized her. When the ladies of the town came to offer condolences after death, as is our custom, notice all this emphasis on custom and manners. Miss Emily shows no grief. She told them that her father was not dead. She did that for 3 days. Notice there's a I mean, that's kind of several signs of weirdness. This is now getting really weird. They told her, look, we need to dispose of the body. So she had kept his body there for 3 days before she finally let them in and they buried. We didn't say she was crazy then. We believe she had to do that. We remembered all the young men her father had driven away, and we knew that with nothing left, she would have to cling to that which had robbed her. Notice, as people will. Notice that line, right? This is certainly foreshadowing what we know from how this story is going to conclude. She would have to cling to that which had robbed her. Okay, so she had been robbed by her father of the chance to have a normal married family life. And so she clung to it, clung to him because she had nothing left. That's part two.